officially present at that meeting. I informed the people that called that there was no plan to have planning board members present. There was going to be a hearing on this application, and that would be the time for the planning board to enter into or receive testimony from various parties on the subject. And we thought that the purpose of the meeting with the developer was for the neighbors to get a chance to get some direct contact, one-on-one, informally with them. So that's how that went. I don't know whether a meeting took place or not. Do you know, Steve?
From what I understand, a meeting did take place last Wednesday. And hearings, second or third hand, there were approximately 25 neighbors in attendance.
Okay, so we'll probably hear something about it when they come before the board. Okay, that was one item. We did receive a letter from Jerry Angier resigning from the board. I did meet with Jerry prior to his submitting his letter to me and to the town council. He had some excellent suggestions, I thought, in his letter. Certainly understood the reasons why he could not serve, basically being related to pressing personal business. But he did make a suggestion that I've discussed with Steve, and I'd like to just mention to the board. It may be something that we might want to think about at some point, maybe make an official recommendation to the town council, and centered around completeness issues. And I don't want to bring it up as a subject for discussion tonight, but it might be something you might want to think about. His suggestion was basically that completeness issues on applications be the province of the town planner. I modified that a little bit in talking to Steve, and the suggestion I had was that the completeness issue be a recommendation from the town planner with the concurrence of the chairman and vice chairman of the planning board at the time that the agenda is prepared for the meeting the next month, or that month. That way, the completeness issue could be at least discussed with planning board members and concurred with. That wouldn't mean that the planning board itself could not disagree with that finding and bring it before the board at any given time, but it would wipe off from our agenda the completeness issue question. I think it was a worthwhile suggestion. I'm not going to invite comment from the board members right now, but it might be an issue that we might want to discuss at one of our next meetings towards the end as we bring up some issues that we might want to forward to the council for consideration. Town council actions. We did receive some letters from the town manager and from really coming through the town council. Unfortunately, one of them was a bad news letter. I want to make sure we share all the bad news as well as the good news. The bad news being that we were rebuked that we approved the Jonesy application without really the town council having an opportunity to officially approve the change in zone. So we kind of put the cart before the horse. The basic message received was, don't do that again. It's not proper for the town planning board to pass on issues before the town council has had a chance. I don't know whether, Steve, you want to say any more about that, but that's the gist of it that I got out of it. So we stand corrected on that item. We also received two other letters from the town council requiring us to take some action on some ordinance changes. One is a zoning ordinance change on setbacks, and the request was that we have an answer back to the town council by December 1st on that item. I'm suggesting that might be worthwhile to have a discussion and workshop scheduled possibly for our September meeting, just to get a better understanding of that ordinance and make sure it's something that we can comply with. The other item you have copies of concerns a date change in terms of approvals, and I don't feel that really deserves a workshop on. It's something that I would like to have the planning board members look at. If they've got really no problems with it, I think we could pass something back to the town council without going through a workshop on it. It's not that big a deal. Okay. July 9th issue raised. I will be attending a meeting this week on Thursday, I believe, of the land use chairman. I believe that's the chairman of the zoning board, town council, and ordinance committee and planning board. As it's explained to me, it's a periodic meeting that that occurs to make sure that all the various boards in town that have anything to do with land use are together. Some of the issues I plan on discussing at that meeting will be our recent decision to take a look at infrastructure. And at the end of today's meeting, I might want to get, if there is a report from the infrastructure subcommittee, I might like to get just a short verbal understanding of what's been discussed and how much progress we've made on that issue. Are there any other items? If there are, let me put it this way, if there are any other items you'd like me to discuss with these other three chairmen, please let me know at the end of the meeting and I'll make sure that I bring them up. Other correspondence. Oh, we have a requirement to submit to the town prior to August, I believe it's August 1st, material for the town's annual report. Basically, I asked Steve to draft something up that he could share with me towards the end of the month, so we'd be in time. And that'll basically include our list of our new planning board members, or the complete planning board, plus a list of all the projects we've reviewed over the last year. If you have anything in particular you'd like to see go into the town report on actions that the town planning board has taken in the last year, please either let Steve or I know. We'll make sure we try to get it into the report of the planning board. Okay, other correspondence. There was a town council meeting on July 9th. There were three items in that council meeting that affect the planning board. One was a report on the ordinance committee regarding proposed amendments relating to dead-end roads. Do you know if there was any action taken on that?
I believe the action was to, the ordinance committee and town council recommended some changes, and I believe they're going to be sending that back to the planning board for your review.
Okay. So we'll expect to see something in that towards the end of the month. They've also considered a proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance related to setbacks, and we have received that. And interestingly enough, they have considered establishing a school space study committee and take necessary action. Do you know if such a committee was formed?
Such a committee was formed, and they decided not to have a planning board member on the committee per se, but there was some language in their recommendation to set up the committee that talked about having a lot of contact with the planning boards.
Well, at least we accomplished the aim anyways. Maybe there'll be some long-range planning now related to school needs and school building needs. We have received correspondence related to the Spurwink Woods application. I believe it came in signed by a number of neighbors, and I believe this was in the packet, is that
right?
Okay. And let's see, what else do we have here? We also received a letter related to Broad Cove Highlands from Edward and Rachel Perry, Portland Water District, concerning maintenance of a station at the Stonegate North subdivision, and the resignation letter from Jerry Angier. Any other items that we should talk about here as far as? We have a hand-delivered item from Richard Davis on his application, which we received tonight.
No, I received it on Monday.
On Monday.
I handed it out.
Okay. Anything else in the correspondence area that should be mentioned? Okay, I'm sorry that we had to go through all this, but glad that you could bear with me on it. First item on our agenda concerns Richard Davis' request for wetland alteration. This item has been the subject of prior legal action between the town of Cape Elizabeth and Mr. Davis, and on that basis, I would like to request a motion that we go into executive session to discuss with our town attorney, who is here tonight, Mr. Leahy, some of the issues related to this application of a legal nature. Could I entertain that form of a motion?
I second the motion.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? We'll go into executive session. As soon as we complete the discussion of these items, we'll be back out. Thank you. The issue was prompted by a letter that we received in our correspondence by Mr. Kenneth Gray. And on that point, I'd like to ask our town attorney, Mr. Leahy, to give us a legal opinion on this letter, maybe review its essence, and provide us an opinion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
For the record, would you please identify yourself?
Right. Tom Leahy. I'm the town attorney. What you have before you tonight is a continuation of a wetlands alteration permit application by Richard Davis. It was filed on or about the 1st of September, 1989. The date of the application is August 28th, 1989. The applicant appeared before this planning board in October of 1989. At that time, his matter was tabled, and you have received, as part of the letter from Mr. Gray, minutes of what happened at that meeting. Mr. Gray has asked the planning board determine whether Mr. Davis's application should be considered under the wetlands alterations provisions existing prior to May 9th, 1990. As you're all aware, there were substantial amendments made to the wetlands ordinances at that time. Mr. Gray has suggested to you that Mr. Davis had not received the required substantive review prior to the enactment or the effective date of the new ordinance. His position is that based upon those minutes and the action taken at that time, that there simply was not a review of his application against the criteria set forth in that ordinance. I have reviewed the minutes of the meeting. I reviewed my notes, my recollection, and I have asked Mr. Davis if he wished to submit anything to the planning board on this issue, factually or legally, because I think it truly is a threshold issue. Are you under the old or the new? You have to know which church you're in here, let alone the right pew. I think you have to know whether you're which way you're going to go on that before you consider any other aspects of this tonight. So the first question is whether the application was pending, the primary issue being what was done last October. I have reconsidered my advice to the town, to you, this planning board, and based upon both the law and the facts presented, it would be my opinion that the application was not pending at the time of the ordinance change. I say that because there was no substantive review as required by state law. It's not a local ordinance, it's state law. It's Title I, MRSA, Section 302. The state legislature has now drawn a more clear line as to what pending means and what review must be had before town before a matter will be deemed pending and governed by an earlier ordinance. And that test is whether or not the party has had a substantive review. It's no longer the filing date. No longer issues of completeness, is whether or not you've crossed a threshold step of reviewing the substance of the application. And I guess when you peel it all back and review those minutes of October 19th, 1989, I do not find any evidence of a review of his application against the criteria of 1939. There was discussion as to whether the application was complete. There was discussion as to what the planning board could do. There was a request that you make a recommendation to the town council, and the answer was you would not make that recommendation without input of other experts on the issue. The recommendation of the council would have been to the effect that they should change the map. On a specific issue as to whether the alteration activity required compliance with the provisions of 1939, I think it's fair to review the minutes and see that Mr. Davis did not proceed for whatever reason, and that's open to question, I suppose, but not proceed to have a substantive review. There was further no public hearing at that time. So based upon the above, and certainly if Mr. Davis and any other party, including Mr. Gray, want to address that issue, they may be allowed to at your discretion. I also should add at this point that the question has come up, well, what effect does the decision of the Superior Court have on this issue? I don't think it has any effect, although I'm sure Mr. Davis disagrees. I think what the Superior Court decided in this matter, the matter being an injunction sought by the town to prevent alteration, what the Superior Court decided was that Mr. Davis's land in issue where the alteration took place, which may not be exactly where and is not exactly where all of the proposed activity or alteration would take place, but it's on the same land, but maybe not all the same. Where that alteration took place may or may not be a wetland. But whether it is or not, it was a mapped wetland. And as a mapped wetland, the town's ordinances require that it either get the town council to amend that map or get a permit. So I don't think that has anything to do with whether he had a pending application. Had he simply gone away and come back 10 years from now, he'd be governed by whatever wetlands laws or ordinances you have then. If he came back in the next day, and he presumably would have been grandfathered, or he presumably would have been treated under the ordinance in effect up until the May 9th, 1990 date of the new ordinance provisions. So I don't think it's directly related as to the case, but I know that's an issue, and I just wanted to present that to you. Again, Mr. Davis may have another view that the case controls and what have you, and I won't speak for him because he can speak to that issue. If you have any other questions, I'd be glad to answer them. It's kind of a long case, has been around for a while, and the issue has been around for a while, so I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Any board have any questions for Mr. Leahy? Thank you. Mr. Davis, do you have anything to add to clarify this point?
Well, I'll be very brief. As to the first question raised by Mr. Leahy, at the October 17th meeting, I had a soil scientist here. I had other documentation. I was prepared to go through it. It was made very clear to me that that would be a waste of time because there'd have to be a public hearing, et cetera. And at that time, as far as I was concerned, it was a very simple issue. All I wanted to do was show that this land was not wetland. And for one reason or not, we never did resolve it. And incidentally, I came to that meeting at the request of my counsel and counsel for the town of Cape Elizabeth. It was an attempt to see if we couldn't work out some solution to the litigation. It wasn't my idea to even come to the board. But anyway, I did, and I came in good faith. Now, I think that, as far as I'm concerned, for that meeting, whether it was substantive or wasn't substantive, I mean, I did not go forward because it was made very clear that there was no point in it. So we returned to court. Mm-hmm. And eventually, we obtained a court decision. And I think Mr. Leahy has presented, very accurately, the history of this, except it may be unclear in part because part of this land was wetland and part wasn't. It's difficult to follow. But in any event, I think that when the court said that if I show that a portion of this land is not wetland, then a permit should issue, to me that's very clear. And I think it's academic as far as applying and going through a wetland alteration process. I don't even think it's necessary. Under the current town wetland map, from what I've been able to learn from the map, I mean, this land is no longer even classified wetland, the fill land, the land that was in issue. Mm-hmm. And if that be the case, it seems to me that it's a simple determination. I mean, is it wetland or isn't it wetland? And unfortunately, we seem to go back and forth here, and I think the planning board is caught in one of your typical crossfires
where you waste a lot of time in executive sessions and legal technicalities and changing of positions, you know, when you should be spending your time planning. So, I mean, that's really all I have to say. It's pretty clear to me, is it wetland or isn't it wetland? This is still land. And I think I've shown through the documents that I presented to this board that it is not wetland. And I think that the court concurs in that. And I think that the soil scientist for the town concurs in that. And I don't think this board even has to address, you know, the issues raised by the recent letter, which I just received today about 11 o'clock. And, you know, we just go on from there. But, you know, I'd like a decision one way or another. I mean, it'll be almost a year, you know, since I first applied. But I think it's absurd, you know, with the continuous flow of information that I've provided to this planning board and also through the court system to perhaps suggest to me that even though all of this was, you know, long before the new wetlands ordinance was passed, that for some reason I have to reapply under the new wetlands ordinance. Because I can tell you, you know, straight away that I will not do that. Mm-hmm. So what I'd appreciate from this board, you know, is a decision. Is this wetlands or isn't it? And if it isn't, then I want to get on with what I'm doing. And if you determine that it is, or I have to go through some additional procedure, and then I'll deal with it. That's about it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The issue before us then, to decide is, do we have a pending application at this point in time, or has there been a pending application? I would invite, there are no questions from the planning board at this point in time, I would invite a motion to that effect, and we could get into some discussion on the motion. Is there anybody prepared to make a motion on the on whether this is a pending or application or not, to clear that point up first?
Motion.
Mr. Timpson.
And having been involved throughout the process of this application from some time ago, I think it may be appropriate for me to make this motion. I would move that we order the planning board makes the following findings of fact as to whether the wetlands alteration application of Richard Davis, originally dated August 28, 1989, and is later joined by Arlen Davis and as supplemented since that date for past and proposed wetlands alterations activity on lot map U3, lot 35 in the vicinity of Cottage Farms Road, Woodland Avenue and Elmwood Road was pending under the provisions of the wetlands alteration provisions of the zoning ordinance 1939, in effect prior to May 9, 1990, or the provisions made effective that date. Findings of fact, A, Richard Davis submitted an application dated August 28, 1989 with supporting materials and supplemented through early October 1989 to the town planner in regard to his request for a planning board permit to alter lands delineated as wetlands on the official town wetlands map. B, while the submitted materials did not appear to be a complete application for wetlands alteration, the matter was nonetheless submitted to the planning board and placed upon the October 19th, 1989 agenda. C, although Mr. Davis appeared, apparently with his soil scientist Albert Frick, he did not submit testimony or otherwise attempt to satisfy the criteria for a wetlands alterations permit as set forth in 1939 as then in effect. Instead, it appears he simply stated his position that the proposed activity was not and would not be upon actual wetlands and that he should not have to satisfy the criteria. A review of the minutes and the vote of October 19, 1989 meeting clearly establishes that there was no substantive review of his application to determine compliance with the review criteria and other applicable requirements of law. Decision, be it therefore ordered that the planning board determines the wetlands alteration application, of Richard Davis and Arlen Davis, originally dated August 28, 1989, and as supplemented to date, was not pending when the new provisions of the zoning ordinance regarding regulation of wetland alterations 1939 became effective May 9, 1990, and hence shall be reviewed by the planning board under the present ordinance provisions made effective May 9, 1990.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
Discussion on the motion.
Chairman, I have just two questions. One, has it been, I see a letter that was hand-delivered stating that Mr. Davis is including his son as part of the application. Do we have confirmation from his son that he, in fact, is part of the application?
Mr. Davis, do you care?
No, the only confirmation you have is from my letter. I said that he was.
And the other question I have, is I would direct to the town attorney. I just have a little trouble understanding the language in the introductory paragraph. Following about two-thirds of the way down Avenue and Elmwood Road, comma, was pending under the provisions of the wetlands alterations provision of the zoning ordinance. It sounds as though, or at least it seems when I read that, it says in the introductory paragraph that it was pending, and then in the summary or decision it says that it isn't.
I appreciate that, Mr. Emery. The introductory clause is the board makes the following findings of fact as to whether the wetlands alteration description thereof was pending.
I see.
It's a long sentence. We should have shortened it.
Okay.
So it's whether it was pending.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Hearing none, I'd like to call a vote. All those in favor of this motion as made, please signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Passes unanimously. This means that we are under the new wetlands alterations permit application, and I guess I would ask you, Mr. Davis, would you like us to go through the checklist on that item tonight, or would you prefer to review and submit your application under that permit application at some later time?
No, as I stated, I have no intention of filing under the new application. And the only thing I'd like to say for the record is that I disagree with the defendant's characterization.
Mr. Chairman, could you use the microphone?
Yes, would you please use the microphone?
So, and I'd like it on record that I disagree with his characterization of the minutes of that meeting. I did have Mr. Crick here, and we were prepared to go through the criteria. And as I stated earlier, it was made very clear to me that there would be no point in doing that. And that's why we didn't do it. I didn't have Mr. Frick here, you know, just to observe what was going on. I intended to have him go through the criteria. And I stated to the board that I could satisfy the criteria. And I rely on that then. I think the court decision supports that point, and I rely on it now. So I understand the problem that you have, and I respect your position. And you make your decision. You've made your decision, and I'll act on that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item. Be sent to Mr. Davis summarizing the decisions of the board, indicating that he is now under the new wetlands application permit. We'll go on to our next item on the agenda. Kevin Zorski, LC Thibodeau, And are there, before we get into this issue, are there any problems related to voting members on the board?
I have a conflict with this.
Okay.
I did the legal research on the road.
Okay.
For the applicant.
Okay, and we would let it be known that Judith Kane is excused on this issue. That leaves us with four members.
Mr. Chairman.
Mm-hmm.
Last month I abstained from voting. Mr. Zorsky is a past college roommate and acquaintance of mine. I think it's unfortunate we don't have a quorum if that's mm-hmm. the situation. I sort of pondered the decision. I think it sort of has set precedence in the past month by abstaining. My understanding is if there's a conflict of interest or what might appear to be,
mm-hmm.
that we're best to abstain. And I think I've unfortunately got to abstain from voting.
Okay. The only question I was going to ask, unfortunately, Steve left, but maybe somebody else could remember. There was a change in our quorum rules. Does anybody remember how that was changed? Do we have to have four, or can we get to... Is there a circumstance that we could get by with three?
It's too bad Mr. Leahy left.
As
I remember, and there may be more discussions than the final result, that we needed a quorum of four for mm-hmm. holding a meeting. But I remember some discussion about a majority of those present and voting who could vote, then still constituting a quorum for a particular issue. When Steve gets back, I think we should ask him that question. But I would think with three of five members present being able to vote on a particular issue that we should be able to do that.
Since we do have five members, even though two have abstained, there are five members here. I think we have some, let's call it, tentative grounds to proceed. And I'm going to suggest that at this point in time we do proceed, and when Steve gets back in, we'll ask the question on the voting aspect of this. So with these problems in front of us, Mr. Zorsky, would you prepare to come before us and we'll have a discussion? The question refers to quorum requirements and our recollection that we can go ahead with it. You wouldn't got it, great. Excuse me, Mr. Zorsky, before you get started, I think we have some wording to help us out here. Could you review this for us, Mr. Butler?
Okay, in terms of a quorum for the meeting, the Planning Board rules and regulations state that a quorum for a meeting shall consist of at least four members and or associate members of the board.
We have that.
We have. In terms of voting, then, the language reads as follows, that is, the affirmative vote of a simple majority of the members present and voting shall be required to approve a motion.
On that basis, then, I'm going to take my prerogatives as chairman and say we can go ahead with this application with three members of the planning board active in the vote. Thank you. Now, could you proceed, sir?
Yeah, I'm Kevin Zorsky, applying for public access waiver, and was here last month and was asked to get proof of deeded access to my lot on Beacon Lane. And Judith Kane did the research, and I submitted letters to the board that I hope you all have.
Mm-hmm.
The only other thing I have in addition is a letter from the neighbors of that lot who live on the dirt portion of Beacon Lane, and I've made copies of that letter that I'd like to give to the board if I could.
We can take that. I'm not sure we can take it officially. I think it would have to be given to our planner. We'd have to have it distributed.
Okay.
You are aware of the deadlines for receipt of information?
Yeah.
Okay.
What the letter says, in effect, is that the people who live on the dirt portion of that road have no problem with a new building being constructed there, but they really don't want the road to be changed, and they think that any alterations in the road will increase traffic flow. and they don't want to see that happening. So.
Then I guess I'll dive in with some questions if other people don't. It still begs the question in my mind as to how you are going to successfully get emergency vehicles into that lot, given that at some point, if I remember where those rocks are put in the road narrows down to less than 25 feet in width, or maybe even less than that. I guess that's got to be a concern, and how would you suggest that be?
You have a letter from the fire chief who says that he's familiar with the road and has no problem with it, and says that emergency vehicles can get up the road without a problem.
Mr. Chairman, maybe a point of clarification. One is that letter was written before, back I think when the idea was that the fire vehicles would go in one part of Beacon Lane and straight out the other. That may not be as much of an issue. I mean, it may be an issue that can be resolved by checking with the fire chief. The other issue, though, is part of the memo stated that fire chief would like to see the rocks that are in the road removed and kept removed.
Right. And if I understand what you said earlier, that won't happen, because the letter that you just put before us indicates that the neighbors are not opposed as long as the road stays the way it is, and I assume that includes the rocks in the road.
The rocks in question are have been put in by one of the neighbors, mm-hmm. and they're not structurally part of the road in any way. They were added on top of the road.
But I guess the question would be, will they be there when a fire vehicle tries to access the road?
I think if the fire chief deems that that road is, or the people living on that road are in danger with those rocks there, then they should be removed. I think that...
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah. Yes.
Regardless of the application before us, wouldn't it possibly be that the fire chief would have notified those landowners and requested that those rocks be removed?
It's possible. We don't have knowledge of that, but it's possible, I guess.
What I'm getting at is it seems to me as though we have an unsafe condition, whether there's an applicant before us or not.
That's right.
And that I don't know that it's the applicant's responsibility to that his application rests on, solely his application rests on the fact that those rocks are removed. I don't think he's the one who's really instigated that problem.
Mr. Chairman, I could check into that. I think the question may be how far the town wishes to pursue matters relating to a private road. I will check with the fire chief and see what his response is.
That's where I'm not clear, Steve. I don't know what responsibilities the town has in terms of protecting property on a private road. Presumably, I really don't know. Is it the fire department's responsibility to chase fires down at the end of half-mile-long private roads? I assume that yes, it is, since they're citizens and taxpayers of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
I think one of the things we're doing here is we're addressing the issue of a public access waiver. If we vote for this public access waiver, we're saying, I guess, that the public access waiver is constructed in a way that would allow access to property at the end of that public access waiver. And there are other issues, too, which we'll get to in a minute concerning site distances and other areas. So I think that's one of the things we have to consider, whether it's practical, that this is a practical public access waiver. Mm-hmm. With the conditions we have before us.
Mr. Chairman, there's also a question of historical properties that exist there before ordinances, mm-hmm. and those that, through a safety valve, or which is our public access waiver provision, allowed to locate in a new fashion on a road. And one of the clear standards that this planning board placed in its ordinance, recommended to the town council, and the town council is very strong on it, is whenever we use the safety valve, there will be a clear way of getting public emergency access vehicles to a particular property. So it's I think, properly a question before us that we have to make sure as a planning board, before we allow that safety valve to kick in, that there is clear, unintruded access to a property. Mr. Chairman, I was not here at the last planning board meeting, since I'm now one of three that are going to sit on this. Perhaps, and I don't want I don't want to recreate what happened at the last meeting. That was my fault that I wasn't here and not yours. Could someone spend 2 minutes just indicating which way out of this property the proposed access is proposed and what the issues are coming out? I've read the minutes and the notes, but I'm not clear where these rocks are or where this 30-foot, 20-foot, 50-foot area is, and I'm not clear on site distances and that sort of thing.
Mr. Zorsky, could you take Mr. Tinsman up that road starting from the Two Lights Road point of entry, not the lighthouse end, and indicate, he's got the map in front of him, where the rocks are and how you propose to get to that property, because I believe that's the only access we're now talking about. We're not talking about access from any other point.
Further to that, Mr. Chairman, also, we typically have a sidewalk for public access waivers, mm-hmm. and have you, as a planning board, had a sidewalk yet?
No, we have not. Okay. That's one of the things we have to determine tonight.
Okay, Mr. Tinsman, do you have a copy of a kind of a blow-up? There's three maps that I submitted originally.
I do.
One of them is a blow-up of the intersection of Two Lights Road and Beacon Lane.
I presume I have that.
Okay, because on that I've marked roughly where the rocks are.
Okay.
And that will give you some idea.
And you're coming out and going west to get out onto Two Lights Road?
Yes. So the rocks in question are bordering the Clark property.
So there's a legal right to exit that way?
Yes, I have deeded access there.
You could present that legal opinion, right, that you can't access that way.
Excuse me?
You can present the legal opinion that you can enter.
Yes, I think you all have copies of that.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify too, though, I think the issue may still remain as to how wide the actual right-of-way is. It appears that Zorsky Thibodeau lot has access. It sounds like it's difficult to ascertain through the titles and everything that's happened how wide that is. You assume it's for some sort of vehicle. Mm-hmm. Based on its historic usage, but I'm not sure, if you're talking about 6 feet, 10 feet, 20 feet.
That's not mentioned. That's not specifically noted. There's a couple of other issues on this that you should be aware of, Mr. Tinsman. The other is the question on site distance. Coming out of the property onto Two Lights Road, I believe the measured site distance going to the right is 255 feet. Is that accurate?
That's what the map says.
Those were my measurements.
Those were your measurements.
Yeah.
Could you review how you made those measurements?
I took a stick, had a base on it that I could stand up in the middle of the road, and I measured, on the map there it shows, I measured 26 feet from the center of Two Lights Road. And I painted the top of the stick white. And I simply went down the road each way and went to where I'd stop seeing that stick. And I measured that point.
Have you read our ordinance requirements vis-a-vis site distances and
yes,
how that's supposed to be measured?
That's what it was based on. The location of the stick was the height of the stick and how far from the middle of the road was based on those.
Was based on?
Yeah.
What is the speed limit on that stretch of road?
I believe it's 25.
It is 25. Okay, I just don't recollect. So 250 feet would be the requirement. You've got 255 by everybody. That's pretty close.
Right.
Has the police department commented on speed limits and site distances?
They've commented on the fact that there were no accidents in that area. They weren't asked to measure the site distance.
And there's no way of going out the other way in the property, Beacon Lane?
It appears that there isn't any legal right to use it at this point in time.
no legal right to go that way.
What was the letter from the neighbors this evening?
That it appears as though it was the neighbors on the unpaved portion heading out towards Two Lights Road that were stating that they didn't have any problem. Just a moment, I'll look at the letter.
I apologize, that letter is late. I had trouble getting hold of some of the neighbors and before the deadline.
Okay, the names that are assigned to it would be James Morang, Pauline Neipert. Let me see, I'm not sure where Neipert is here. Okay, Francis Doyle, Delphine Clark, and
Donald Hale is the last name.
Okay. You say so. Donald Hale, I assume. Doesn't look like that.
Is the lot owner that is in the lot near where the rocks were placed included in those signatures?
I believe she is, if that's Delphine Clark.
Okay.
But the letter states that that they're all owners and occupants of homes on the gravel portion of Beacon Lane that we're talking about. They foresee no difficulty on a new home being constructed on the 2.5-acre lot on Beacon Lane currently owned by Kevin Zorski and Elise Thibodeau. They further state, we do not see the need to have the gravel road paved, widened, or altered in any way, as we feel that to do so will attract more traffic to our road. We hope that the members of the planning board will take our wishes into consideration. Sincerely.
Okay. There is another question now on this issue, and maybe you could comment on the fact that this public access will serve more than three lots. Do you care to comment on that point?
My only comment is that it's served more than three lots for years now, and to distinguish it from a subdivision being put in, which would be more of a typical public access waiver for a private road. This is not a subdivision, it's a lot that was sold, and we want to build on it. And the neighbors don't mind, and the fire chief doesn't mind, the police doesn't have a problem with it. So I don't feel that because it serves more than three lots, I think that those laws were intended for people putting in roads to serve new homes, not to a road that's been there for years serving roads. I don't see why it should be altered for one home that's being added to it.
Mr. Chairman, can I help? I see some names that I recognize on these drawings. Who did you buy your lot from?
From Hamilton.
Okay.
They lived on the Pavlov house.
They live where?
They lived in the Pavlov house, the house currently owned by Pavlov.
Okay.
It seems to me that we have before us an application that is borderline, to say the least. And I would entertain a motion tonight from the members of the planning board to take action on this, or possibly to delay action so that we could take a site visit, which we have not done for this at all, as you noted, Mr. Pinsman. I, for one, would like to see that site distance and how that was measured directly. I think it's so close, it's very close to call. 5 feet is out of 255 feet is not a lot of margin for error. And site distance on that road is extremely critical, especially during the summertime. There's a lot of traffic going down that road. That would be one area of concern. The other area of concern would be what's it like to access that road only? And has the fire chief and the police and safety looked at only access from one point? And I'm not sure from the answers that I got from Mr. Butler and from you that that's the case, because we have to look at the application as it's presented to us. The application is presented to us right now is a car coming in off Two Lights Road to your lot, turning around and going back out that way. So are there turnarounds available? Can a fire truck do that? And is that something that the fire chief is willing to do? I don't know whether we have any word on that at all.
Well, I don't have legal access to exit on the easterly end.
That's right.
Lane, but the fire chief sure does.
Mm.
So, yeah, I mean, there's no way he's gonna, there's no way he's going to turn around. Why should he?
I think the applicant raises a good point. One issue is at some point in the future, if that was ever blocked off, which it appears as though the owners have the right to do, it might be a problem. The question would be, you know, could somebody get out there, depending upon how it was blocked, if it was a chain, could the fire crew get out and, you know, clip through the chain or
no,
a permanent marker? It might cause more problems.
Will that stretch of road be plowed in the winter, the whole road?
The whole road is always plowed in the winter, and all the members of Beacon Lane contribute to the plowing and the maintenance of the road.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman,
yep.
May I guess, make a couple of comments, and perhaps unfair because I wasn't here last time, but philosophically, we should, as a planning board and as a town, be ensuring that property rights of individuals are maintained, however that's expressed by votes of the planning board. And to the extent that there are provisions or ways to encourage the appropriate use of land in a safe and environmentally sensitive manner, that's something that this board has to review and then concur and vote to allow something to happen in the case of a public access waiver. Philosophically, I'm very supportive of a person who has a piece of land that they have purchased for the construction of a house, and there are provisions in our ordinance that allow, as a safety valve, that person to then build on that land, as long as they meet the common, the benchmark criteria that the council has given to us to administer. And we have to make sure that those benchmark criteria are maintained on a consistent basis throughout the community. Where that can be shown, then we should vote to allow the public access waiver. I would hope that we can find that for this applicant. I would like to, and in all cases, we've gone out to the public access waiver site, taken a look at it, and ensured from a visual standpoint, not only in map form, that it meets those criteria. I would like to propose that. And I guess what I'm saying is that I would like to be able to make a finding that the public access waiver standards and criteria have been maintained and met, and where they're not met, then we should condition the application on that and go forward. Site distance is one of the biggest issues in this. I know that area as a paper boy. I delivered papers in that area as 10 years old, so I've traveled the site a lot. But frankly, I don't remember where 255 feet is and whether that's adequate distance or the speed limits in that location. So, Mr. Chairman, I would propose that we set a site walk for this as soon as possible, and that we bring it back at the earliest convenient time for action, either granting or denying the public access waiver.
We're in the review process, so I'm not sure that even has to be made as a motion at this point in time.
What, the site walk?
Yeah.
Well, just setting a site walk.
Yeah, I think we just want to do that.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question regarding the site walk. Are you looking for the site distances and as a basis for understanding, I guess, as a level of safety of the intersection, or as a minimum criteria of meeting the ordinance? And if he doesn't meet the ordinance, then it goes into the record that he hasn't, but that's public knowledge and that's a condition of approval. What I'm getting at is that there are engineering standards that regardless of how well a road is engineered, people can drive correctly or incorrectly. And it seems to me that one of the measures of the qualities of an intersection and designs of an intersection, sometimes conversely, and that is that the more potentially dangerous an intersection may be, perhaps the more time people take at that intersection and the fewer accidents one would find there. But the point I'm trying to get to is that we have before us evidence from the police chief that there's been 5 years of no record of an accident there. I don't disagree with you, Dick, that it's appropriate to go out and measure the site distance, but I think I'm where you are philosophically. I don't understand fully what the implications are if we find inadequate site distance, what that would mean to the applicant, and I'd like the applicant to understand what we're getting at here.
Okay. I think basically we're being told of a plan on how this lot is going to be used. That intersection may not be heavily used right now that way. I don't know right now how people access their homes in that area. They may all come through Beacon Lane for all we know. This public access waiver is saying, no, I'm going to come in that intersection, and I'm going to leave through that intersection. And so, therefore, site distance is a factor. And I think site distance is an important aspect of us determining that a public access waiver obeys the laws related to public safety. And so public safety is going to be an issue. And the fact that there haven't been any accidents there as yet, I think is good, but I mean, I don't think that's necessarily sufficient to say that there won't be in the future if we decide to go ahead with this and it's got inadequate site distance.
Is there a precedence for granting public access waivers with less than adequate site distances?
I'm not sure. I don't.
It hasn't happened in the past, but what I mentioned at the last planning board meeting throws a certain twist to the whole matter, and that is that the chairman was asking about, or making the point that this was going to serve three lots at a minimum. I mean, it serves more, but at least to that lot. The planning board may just want to look at the distance between the applicant's lot and two light, where it, Beacon Lane hits Two Lights Road. The ordinance, as it stands now, states that if that's the case, if a public access waiver roadway would serve three more lots, then it has to meet the subdivision ordinance standards. Unless, but then the further caveat is, unless the planning board then can find that unless the planning board finds that the proposal can meet the waiver provisions in the subdivision ordinance. What it comes down to is that once the public access waiver serves three lots, you invoke a very a much more rigorous set of standards. However, those standards can be reduced to any level which the planning board feels is appropriate. So you can reduce it down to the existing set of public access waiver standards for one or two lots, or you can reduce it even more. In the past, that I don't think has happened. It's always been a situation where it served one or two lots, and therefore the planning board's always applied the applicable standards at the time. But this is a slightly different situation.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, I would think that we would want to be sensitive to the neighbors down there and their request for not having a full subdivision level road going in there. But I think we also have to be careful, and there is precedent in this planning board that we cannot waiver or waive the standards of the public access waiver requirements, the 22 feet, the 50-foot travel surface, and those standards. Perhaps we can the subdivision, but not the public access waiver standard.
And we've had some recent cases where we've had to go back and make decisions after the fact, right? I'm hearing a request for a site visit, and I'd like to set a date for that. And then if that is agreeable to people who are left on the planning board, I'd like to be able to do that. Tom? Okay.
That's agreeable with me.
When would you like to see that happen?
Whenever you can get out there.
I don't think that's going to take a long time.
Can we do it at night, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
After work?
I would suggest that.
Mosquitoes are bad at night.
Well, if we can get there at 5:30, maybe it will beat the mosquitoes. Say we set it for 6 o'clock on... what's our deadline for this next meeting?
Deadline for the next meeting is August 3rd.
August 3rd.
Do we have a workshop session in August?
August.
We have that scheduled. Yeah.
Is it 14th?
14th.
August 14th.
Second Tuesday.
Yeah, we decided to skip the first Tuesday. Why we did?
Because I wasn't going to be around.
You were not going to be around. Okay. And others. So we went to the second Tuesday.
Okay.
I was going to suggest the week of the 23rd of July. Anybody's good?
It's okay with me.
It's fine with me.
As long as it's not Tuesday, infrastructure subcommittee is going to be meeting Tuesday at 5:30.
You want to try for, say, Wednesday at 5:30, the 25th?
Notices go out?
Yep. This will be a site walk at Zorsky Thibodeau. you will indicate where to our planner where we can park so that
how many cars
so we get off the road.
How many
there'll
cars?
There'll be at least four.
Okay.
Maybe five.
We'll want to get off Two Lights Road because that probably is pretty heavily traveled. So we indicate where we can park. And we will.
Mr. Chairman, could we take this up at our workshop meeting in August? If it's if the sidewalk produces some feeling that it's appropriate.
Take it up for a decision and a vote?
Yes.
I'm not sure.
You can if you decide to hold a special planning board meeting. You'd have to set one up. You can't. The planning board's not able to make an official decision at a workshop, per se.
We'd have to open a planning board meeting, close a planning board meeting, I guess is what we'd have to do. Seeing that it's 1 week prior to our regular meeting, I'm not sure it'd be worth all the notices. That'd be my thought on it. We'll see about the sidewalk,
okay.
And then hopefully we'll have enough resolution at that point to go to a vote.
Okay, great. Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Mr. Tinsman, what you had said about minimum requirements for the waiver that cannot be waived, could you just explain that a little bit?
I don't have my ordinance here. If somebody gives me an ordinance, I can tell you what they are, but they're listed in the ordinance.
Excuse me.
Minimum width of dedicated access right-of-way shall be 30 feet. Minimum pavement width shall be 22 feet. Paving shall be required for a distance of 50 feet from edge of the street paving. Maximum grade, the first 50 feet of the drive shall be 2%. Pavement radius at intersection shall be 20 feet. Sight distances in each direction shall be 10 feet for each mile per hour posted speed on receiving street, or if police records indicate actual speeds posted exceed posted speed, sight distance shall be based on posted speed or 80% of actual, and you can read that as well as I can. And then 7, gutter drainage along the street shall not be allowed to sheet across the face of the intersection.
So none of those requirements that you just read can be waived by the planning board, is that correct?
That's my understanding.
I don't think we ever have.
Clarification, I think under this, the town attorney's interpretation is they could be if the planning board could find, the interpretation is the planning board could do that as part of its wavering of the subdivision standards. Once you enter the waiver provision, it opens the door. I think Mr. Tinsman's stating that the planning board may wish to consider the public access waiver standards as a minimum. But the way I understand the ordinance language to have been interpreted by the town attorney, there's no absolute requirement that be the case.
And the issue, of course, then is the minimum right-of-way, the 30 feet. And I think we should take a look at that, Mr. Chairman. I'm not opposed to...
I like to drive the road and see what it means. You know, what does the width of the road mean right now in terms of getting in and getting out? It'll be a judgment I make when I see how my car survives, I guess. Did you get your question answered?
Yes.
Okay. Right.
So my understanding then is that the planning board can waive any requirements. There are no requirements that cannot be waived.
As long as it can make a finding, it's required to make a finding. It has to find that the number of standards can be met in granting any of the waivers, some of which pertain to meeting a minimum amount of, you know, road and traffic safety.
And then we may have to condition final granting.
Right. Okay, thank you.
I understand it. Okay, thank you. We're running behind, but maybe we can do something to catch up. The next item on our agenda is Michelle and Paul Sear, Cindy Lyon Daycare Center for 9 children at 95 Leiden Lane. Do we have representatives of the applicant present tonight?
Mr. Chairman, would you like any public comment from affected property owners on that last matter to give you some guidance?
We are not in a public hearing situation, so we cannot receive any information that way. You're invited to submit written comment if you'd like. Or you could possibly attend the site walk too if you'd like. We have a date for that established.
Thank you. In other words, there won't be any public comment on the process.
There's no public hearing plan, as far as I know, as far as the public access waiver is concerned.
As the owner of the West Beacon, I really would like to provide you some additional documents, and I will do so before your site visit.
Don't. That would be fine. We could take that under consideration at our next meeting as part of the site visit walk. Yeah. Okay. We do have an item. We did have an item on the agenda. We probably should vote to table it so that we are. Are we tabling or are we continuing? I guess that's the question I would have.
I would guess with either. I mean, I guess the board in the past is normally table.
Is this the next issue?
No, we're talking about Zorsky.
You said the sidewalk, and I think implicit perhaps was the tabling, but the question was whether or not the planning board wants to officially table.
Move to table.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Table. Okay, now we're on to our next item. Shell and Paul Sear daycare facility. Do we have anybody representing Shell and Paul Sear?
Okay.
Nobody's here?
Maybe we're back on schedule.
We're back on schedule. Next item, Ms. Sproul.
Should we move, because it's on the agenda, to table this until the applicants come in?
Well, I would entertain a motion to that effect.
Yep. I move that the application of Michelle and Paul Sear for, Michelle and Paul Sear, Cindy Lydon Daycare Facility, be tabled until the next meeting.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Mr. Chair.
Discussion?
Point of order?
Point of discussion, perhaps. Just in case the applicants decide to show up, would you want to perhaps have a motion that would either to next meeting or it
to the next meeting or to
later in this meeting.
Second. Okay. Is there any further discussion? I guess that's wrong. Any further discussion? None. All those in favor? Opposed? Now we're on to our next item, Mr. Drinan. We're talking about Sperlink Woods. Can you please come forward and identify yourself? Sperlink Woods, 17 Lot Major Subdivision, McCullough Road, Shembus Road, Preliminary Plan Review, Section 6-2-4 of our ordinances. Welcome.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Edward Drinan. And we skipped, as you know, the June meeting at our mutual request. And we're back tonight having given us the opportunity to provide you and you the opportunity to review a number of issues from our meeting of 2 months ago. Most of them are technical in nature, and I'd like, if I could, for you, members of the board, to address any questions and concerns you might have to Rick Light, a civil engineer from Land Use Consultants. If there are matters of philosophy regarding the development proposal, I'd be happy to answer those.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Light, could you please identify yourself for the record? We'll see if we have some questions.
Rick Light from Land Use Consultants.
Okay, I've got one that I'll start it off with, and then maybe the rest of the planning board members might want to chime in. I know when I took the site walk with Mr. Drinan, and we walked down the road, you mentioned a plan to preserve trees. Mm-hmm. That plan has had some comment from our police and safety, and I think Mr. Drinan has made an attempt to supply us a plan with a tree plan in effect. Could you comment on what that plan now contains and where it may differ with what police and safety is saying we can do, and maybe make that clear for us?
Yes, I can. I don't have the benefit of seeing or hearing it from the police and safety's comments. Although I talked with Steve, I believe it was this morning, concerning from public safety standpoint, the issue of our request for a waiver in the actual pavement width to 20 feet and the narrowing of the shoulder widths from 8 down to 6 feet to provide less of a clearing overall, as you drive down through the travel corridor. I guess just a back up a step, our philosophy on that design was, I think as we've mentioned in the past, to create a more, a New England town atmosphere with the tighter roadway and saving some of the trees along the boundary. And in doing that, we also took a look at some of the standards which we have to meet, which are the site distances around the horizontal corners. And I believe in Mr. Hunter's recent letter of July 3rd and 3rd and 6th, he addressed the fact that we have looked at those and they appear to be okay, but there, as we reduce the road width down to 20 feet, he still has some concerns about that. I think from an overall safety standpoint, I think we're looking for the board to have, give us some feeling on their thoughts on the reduction. Is our thought more of a philosophical thought that would create for a more aesthetically pleasing subdivision? We weren't looking to save road costs or construction costs. And if the board and the public safety and police have concerns of, with regards to the standards of 24 to 22 or 20 feet, then we would be more than happy to go with a full-width roadway in the alignment that's shown. And I guess to follow that a little bit further, the issue with the cul-de-sac, which again has been brought up in Mr. Hunter's letter, the tree location plan, which we provided, I believe, it's dated June 1st, identifies that, again, the trees along the roadway, which we would intend to save with a reduced road width and shoulder width. As well, we've also called out a different size cul-de-sac, and what, just to clarify that for those that aren't familiar with it, we had asked for a 120-foot diameter cul-de-sac as the ordinance requires, however, having the island within the 120-foot diameter, whereas the ordinance asked for a 140-foot diameter if you're going to go to an island. The original plan did not call for an island. I think there were comments made on the sidewalk which led us to take a look at putting an island in there and saving several trees, which we feel couldn't be saved because of the grading and whatnot. And again, our thoughts on reduced cul-de-sac diameter is simply from a topographical and from a tree-saving standpoint. One was from topographical, that shelf that we walked on the site plan, it fits nicely in a 120-foot diameter cul-de-sac. As we increase to 140, we end up clearing more of what becomes a steeper terrain and cutting into the back of the cul-de-sac. And secondly, to put the island in the middle, again, is more of an aesthetic thing. So our thoughts were to simply go with the 120-foot outside diameter cul-de-sac and an island in the middle. As I understand that the public safety comments, again, would rather see the full-sized cul-de-sac with the full 30-foot pavement, et cetera, around there. Again, we are not disagreeable to doing that. It was simply our thoughts that would create a more pleasing turnaround at that end while still adhering to safety requirements.
I think there's also some questions relating to the Esplanade entrance. We realize that that's an attempt to provide something that looks like a dual entrance into the middle entrance and exit. Public Works is saying that presents some real problems in terms of snowplow. So we've got some problems both with the cul-de-sac, the tree plan, and width of the road as it goes through the property and the entrance. Any other questions?
I guess it's not clear to me what problems it causes the snow plowing.
Bubba, could you give us some comment on the questions and the concerns of the Public Works Director related to the road?
Okay. In addition to Bob, the town engineer's comments, the Public Works Director and I did have a conversation, and he felt that a road width of 20 feet might present some problems during the winter months in terms of snow plowing with cars passing on either side. You had particular concern and comments about the cul-de-sac and with the island and being able to get a plow without chipping away at some of the curbing. And last but not least, I guess he had some serious reservations about the idea of the split entrance. The Esplanade sort of concept that the applicant is proposing at this point in time, where it would come out onto Macaulay and Cheverus Road. So those were the comments.
He didn't go into a lot of detail in terms of, you know, some of the underlying concerns, other than he just saw some basic problems.
Yes.
I, for one, am from the first time that I saw an Esplanade entrance, which was in Stonegate 4, when they first proposed that, trying to look around. I think they're very nice. I think from an aesthetic point of view, they're attractive. The one that we have at Wildwood is an extremely attractive entrance to that condominium area. And I agree. I'm not sure what the public, what exactly is the basis of the Public Works Department problem. I mean, is it ideally they'd like to have paved, wide roads with huge shoulders? But you know, they managed to get along in Oakhurst, not to, and this is a far cry from what we find in those tiny, narrow, deep houses, cars, kids, dogs, every, you know, there can be something between there. It's the aesthetics are there. I think they'll just have to plow more slowly or be more careful, or is it truly a hazardous situation?
I can't speak with the Public Works Director knowing, you know, all the problems. I have a feeling that the Public Works crew after snowplow in the Oakhurst area probably could have some choice words to say. But.
I think we also have to realize, I hear where you're coming from, but we also have to realize that when the Public Works Director takes a look at the piece of property, it's not a nicely wooded piece of property right now as it exists right now with no houses and no cars going through it. He views it with houses and cars going through it, and that's a little different situation than what exists right now. So what might make a nice winding road could be a public works nightmare when it comes to taking care of it. And he's looking for the best of all worlds, obviously, and directing us accordingly. That's his prerogative. We can certainly think about it ourselves and decide that we don't care for the best of all worlds and would like to see some aesthetics retained. That's certainly our prerogative. But our staff has provided comment related to safety and related to maintenance, and that's where we're coming from, I believe, the Public Works Director. I think that's how we should take it. Mr. Edson.
Mr. Chairman, my comment on the road width, the applicant hasn't, and we haven't recommended a sidewalk in the area. My own sense of a 20-foot wide roadway, whether it's wintertime or summertime, with cars passing each other, pedestrians who have to use the road if there's no sidewalk, that's not a truly public safe way. I think if the applicant would consider a sidewalk when he says that it's truly not a case of expense, that shouldn't be a real issue. If we can perhaps deal with a sidewalk in that area for the pedestrians, that's the only way I would see the 20-foot wide roadway would be acceptable.
I'd like to, I think that's a very good suggestion. Mm-hmm. I would suggest that what that might do is give the applicant an opportunity to wiggle the sidewalk around some of those large trees where he doesn't have that luxury with the road, unless the applicant assumes that the sidewalk's parallel to the street. But it may mean getting easements onto some of these parcels, but I think that's a very reasonable trade-off. I think that's a real good suggestion.
Could you comment on the possibility of a sidewalk? What would you care to?
I'll leave that said. I entertain the, I like the idea from a planning standpoint. And I think we can take a look at what that would do in terms of, I think, what our thoughts are, because the trees are so close to the road that in the right-of-way, I think it'd be tough to meander and actually save trees. There is not enough meander, so to speak, and the trees are so large to really work without trees, like you said, unless we get into individual lots with easements. But I think we could certainly look at that alternative. We haven't really taken a close look, but we'd be glad to look at that.
Can we work in tandem as we go along?
Sure. Go right ahead.
When we're talking about road width,
the record should note that Mr. Dryden is now.
And the cul-de-sacs and the esplanades. I think we're all aware that everyone has a special interest, no matter what the issue is. And when we're talking a development issue and a road issue, and when Public Works gets into the picture, I'm making the assumption Public Works would like to see all roads wide, flat, and straight. And the fire department may ideally like to see a hydrant every 100 feet, and the police department, the very strong lighting and an emergency call box at frequent intervals. The developer may want a narrow road to save money. The townspeople in this town might like to see the winding, curvy, narrow, tree-lined road for purposes of aesthetics. And it's a difficult role that you have to balance all of these special interests coming at you from four or five different directions. Once you have done that, we're, of course, willing and very willing to do whatever you say. If you want a 24-foot road, we'll do it. That's 4 feet wider than Mitchell Road is paved, as you know. If you'd like to see a 20-foot road with a sidewalk that meanders, I'm unfamiliar with any particulars of an ordinance requirement of the construction of sidewalks. I don't know if we have to do a lot of expensive undergrading and certain slope requirements and all of that stuff. But if we can somehow fit in a sidewalk, I'd like the idea of doing that.
I think that's part of the process here, is to get some exchange of ideas and reach some compromises that make sense for both the town and the developer. And we're doing that. Comments on other issues? Unless we've exhausted this issue of the roads and
the issue of the cul-de-sac, does the applicant have any counter-argument to the Public Works or the town engineer's interpretation? Have you tested this with truck templates or anything else that you'd like to counter-argue, or is your dimension strictly based on the area available to locate the cul-de-sac?
It's based on a combination of both. I didn't get a copy of his letter until today. And I haven't had a chance to take a look at it. But taking it from face value, if that's an issue, we don't have a problem, as I mentioned, going to a larger radius, from a public safety and a maneuvering standpoint. We did look at it from a sight distance standpoint, from a curvilinear and a vertical standpoint, so that we do have adequate sight distance, we feel, coming into and out of the cul-de-sac. And our thoughts were not to, obviously, the landscape accordingly, so that sight distance isn't diminished within the cul-de-sac.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I just hope that I answered your question.
Yes, just picking up on your last comment, what design speed do you feel this road is designed to?
I feel that based on your standards, a 30-mile-an-hour, I think that the standard for sight distance, if I am correct, is 200 feet. Which corresponds by Ashito to approximately a 25 to 30 mile an hour zone. A 30 mile an hour zone would be in excess of 200 feet. So we're basing it on around a 25 to 30 mile an hour zone.
Okay, thank you.
Based on your standards.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but one other issue. Would it make sense for the board to entertain the idea of no on-street parking if we go to narrower sidewalks? I know that's contrary to the efficient use of paved area, but in this particular case, if we were to narrow up the road, if the provision of a sidewalk and no on-street parking.
You're saying to narrow the road up and go with sidewalks and no...
No on-street parking.
Limit on
if the lots are large enough in the driveways and would probably be long enough to accommodate most situations.
Subject for discussion on the board.
I don't know. I have a problem with that.
Now you are.
There.
Yeah.
I have a problem with that sort of control. First of all, who's going to enforce it? What happens when someone has a party or Thanksgiving or something and they can't fit all the cars in the driveway? It just seems unwieldy. I don't think parking is, because of the long driveways, parking on the street isn't going to be that big a problem to begin with. And the occasional one when you'd have it is, they're not the people you want to give the tickets to.
Great.
Mr. Chairman, there are arguments on both sides of the on-street parking. One of the problems mentioned by Mr. Bray on Mitchell Road, which evidently is the same width as the applicant's proposing. And one of the problems there is on-street parking causing traffic problems. I foresee the same problem here. It is on-street parking where there's no curb, shoulder is a problem. I want to go back to the cul-de-sac, to the radius of the cul-de-sac. I'm not sure when we were there on the sidewalk. We were in the area of the cul-de-sac. Briefly mentioned the island. It's pretty hard to visualize walking through the woods with the slope still there, the island. My major concern, I mentioned it before, is the engineer, the town engineer mentioned, I think, three sites on the cul-de-sac. There are clearly four, and in actuality, almost really five. If you look at lot 10, the slope in the area of the frontage of lot 10 away from the cul-de-sac pretty much prohibits any driveway into that section. So in essence, you have close to four and a half lots emptying onto the cul-de-sac. I think it would be wise for us to consider a cul-de-sac that can handle that many entries onto the road surface.
Which would mean the more of the standard size.
The 140 foot diameter, 70 foot radius. I have another issue on, it was also mentioned by the town engineer, the drainage in the vicinity of station 1200, which I found on only one map, by the way, that station, which I take it is the drainage area on lot 17, is that correct?
Yes, as you enter the site.
Right. I think the problem there is the way it's drawn now shows drainage in 30 foot drainage, and 15 feet of that stops abruptly at the valley lot. Somehow, I think that's got to be redrawn. I realize that abuts a buffer area. But we go from a 30-foot wide drainage to a 15-foot wide drainage. I think that simply has to be corrected. Number two, perhaps Steve Butler can help us. Is it typical to have the pedestrian easement area in the drainage ditch itself?
No. Usually you keep the two separate and apart for perhaps obvious reasons.
Okay, there was another question. I'm sorry.
Could I just comment on that? Is it my understanding then that let me just clarify what our thoughts were in the design process on that piece there. What we've done is taken, obviously, some of the road drainage from the low point of the entrance, the first 400 feet plus or minus, and that drains through an easement that's actually 30 feet wide and, as it's shown, overlaps 15 feet on the pedestrian easement. And as shown, I guess, on the previous plans, the rear of the valley lots and Loring and Foley, et cetera, contains a 30-foot wide drainage easement, and which goes to an outlet pipe, et cetera, down by the northern cul-de-sac on McCauley Road. And our intention was, and as shown on the plan profile sheet, to discharge a drainage pipe, again, which would be a subsurface pipe, which discharges and ends right about at the property line there into that drainage easement, which, again, it's a wetland area, as shown, and it's a natural drainage swale, which goes behind those lots. If I'm hearing that the town has a problem with the overlapping easements, we can, we'll have to take a look at that and see what we can do about moving it one way or the other. But that was the intent of the design.
And I'm sorry if I didn't see the profile or the drawing of the drainage ditch, but I think, as the town engineer says, that needs to be clarified. Where does that, we don't want to be responsible for leaving that drainage right at the corner of the valley lot. Perhaps your drawing might reference to if there is a 30-foot drainage easement at the back of the valley in Loring, and perhaps the other lots that you might include that. So it just makes rational sense.
I believe some of the revised plans did, and maybe I apologize if some of the other, if more later copies didn't.
I'm looking at the June 1 map.
Yeah, I believe those didn't, and I apologize for that. But they'll take care of that.
Okay.
I just want to make it clear, if the town has a problem, again, with the 15-foot overlap, we'll take a look at moving that one way or the other, so it's not, there isn't a 15-foot overlap onto the accessway, pedestrian accessway.
Okay.
Would you care to comment on the wetlands filling that's going to take place, including the wetland that was not obvious on our prior plans that's now been added? I believe it's shown on lot 11, is it?
Yes, correct. Lot 11, that's correct.
And how was that discovered and why wasn't it available to us prior to this time?
Let me back up a step, I guess, and take an overall picture of the wetlands. There are, in summary, there actually were three wetlands identified on the site by ecoanalysts way back, and the date escapes me, but I would say last fall was when we had that map on the original plan. When they were out there early this spring, doing their wildlife inventory out there, they found that that area that's identified as wetland 4, which is the wetland on wetland 11, wasn't previously mapped, just because the vegetation wasn't evident. So we went out and picked that up by survey, and that's as you see it there. It simply just wasn't seen on their first walkthrough. And what we've done is taken where that impacts lot 11 and the crossing of the driveway to lot 11, we proposed to cross that at the narrowest point and requiring filling on lot 11. We also, again, still propose on the wetland on lot 5, there would be a small filling for the roadway, and again, about 1,000 square feet of fill on the tail of the wetland there for the placement of the house and driveway. So those are the three points of wetland filling that we proposed right now. And I guess what I want to call attention to the fact is that the issues that I'm sure we'll get into in a few minutes, talking about the location of or need for drainage basins, as called out in Mr. Hunter's letter, in July 3rd or July 6th letter, also implies some dealings with wetlands, depending on how we go with detention basins. I think our earliest plan had shown a detention basin in the area of lot 11 in the corner, a very small one, albeit, but in the area of a wetland. So obviously, if that were to be the scheme that the board wants to go with, we would have to include that in our wetland filling or wetland alteration at that point, simply a diking of the wetland, but it would have to be included nonetheless. But as planned, these would be the three wetland crossings that we would foresee right now.
You could not, on lot 5, plan your driveway entrance and your house lot siding so that you missed that altogether? Would it be possible to do that?
I suppose technically anything's possible. It could be done. I think there are, I guess, two points that I think we discussed on the sidewalk, and we worked diligently out in the field to try and site that driveway in and amongst the two ledge knolls. In fact, that's why the driveway was placed there.
Uh-huh.
In addition to tree number 47, which is a 27-inch pine, we specifically wanted to save that tree in there. And what we envision is the driveway hugging the knoll, which is adjacent to the border of lot 4 and 5, and just skirting the edge of that wetland. And putting the house, I guess, back on the sidewalk, if you remember where the hood of the old car was, back in that area there. And again, what we've shown is more of a realistic, I suppose we could minimize that, yes, and push the house back further, but then I think we're into the issue of getting the house close to the rear buffer. If you remember the stand of trees, there's a good healthy stand of trees on lot 5 to the rear, but it's not all, the undercover isn't all that dense, so that in terms of visual impact, we want to keep that a little bit from the property line. Our earlier alternative when we had shown lots 5 and 6 was to actually have a house site on the ledge that the rise and knoll that is up towards the cul-de-sac in the corner of lots 5 and 6. And we still feel, I think, that a house could be sited up there. I want to just remind the board, maybe it doesn't need to be said, but these are actually 1-foot contours on here, where most plans you're used to looking at 2-foot contours. So some of these slopes, and again, you've all been out there so you know what it looks like, but some of these slopes when looking on a 2-dimensional plan are more exaggerated than they really are because they're 1-foot contours. And that we still feel that a house technically could be sited, again, up on the slope with a drive under type house. But we've chosen, I think, to go with the rear based on comments received in the planning board sidewalk to go with a house back where you see the symbol 5 back in that corner there. I think the problem of access as you go into the cul-de-sac and up around the curve in the road is that the road is rising while the grade next to it is falling away, and to have a driveway access there is more or less inconvenient because of the fill required to take you from road elevation down to the plateau where the wetland is. Yes, sir.
We gave an awful lot of thought to that particular lot. As you recall, in our original plans, it was a double lot with lots five and six. We rolled it into one lot. And on our driveway locations, we gave this a lot of thought. We think it's a very pretty entryway, and it snakes in between the two ledges and a couple of large trees there, not only the one indicated, but some others closer to the road. And with that culvert that's going to go under the road between lots 11 and 12, I think a lot of that's going to be drained anyway, but it's really, in my opinion, the best location for a driveway going across a small portion of a relatively small wetland, rather than any other location in any other house site.
Just with a big lot, and I just was curious as to whether there was a way to avoid the wetland issue altogether. But I can understand the rationale. I've got one question, and I'd like to let the rest of the planning board members have a shot at. You're showing on this, I'm looking at your tree plan, tree location plan. You're showing down on lot 17 a landscape buffer, I think is what you're calling it. I know when we took the sidewalk, I believe the comment I heard from you, Mr. Dreiner, was that there really wasn't going to be any buffer there other than the setback, additional setback in the trees that were there. Are you thinking of something different now in that area, or is that still the way you're proceeding?
I think when we were out in the on the site that day, we talked about the conventional the conventional thought conveyed by the term buffering,
yeah,
which means planting of trees. And I hoped I demonstrated that planting of trees would not be successful because of the large mature trees that were there. In this case, buffering was to mean a no-cut zone.
So when you say landscape buffer, that means no cutting.
No cut of existing trees within that area.
Why is it that you feel that the trees won't survive?
New plantings?
Yes.
Because of the canopy of the existing trees. It's a heavily shaded area. I employ, I utilize on a regular basis a firm which transplants trees. It was a topic of discussion before this board a year or so ago.
You mean from the wild?
Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You can take trees that are mature trees up to 6 inches in diameter and pick them up with a big spade and bundle them up and move them somewhere else, and it's instant gratification. That man is a certified arborist. He's the president of last year anyway of the Maine Arborist Association, and I had him out there. We were looking at trees to take elsewhere. We're looking at trees to move. Save, he said that trees would not grow there. A conventional tree would not grow there because of the existing canopy.
Would you ask him specifically if hemlocks would grow there? I'm not proposing that you plant a buffer of hemlocks. I'm just, if there's an opportunity for a tree to survive in that situation, it's probably a Canadian hemlock, which also makes a nice landscape buffer, but it's a very expensive proposition. And maybe...
I'll ask him. We do move hemlocks around, and they don't seem to have a good survival rate, I know.
No, they don't necessarily have a good survival rate moved out of the wild, but if they're nursery-grown and if they're grown under the right circumstances, they are a tree that typically grows in wet situations and with understories.
Yeah, this land is not at all wet there. It's very sparse soil conditions and a lot of ledge right there. But I'll ask him.
Okay. That'd
be worth asking.
Of some concern, it has been a concern all